This would be a great time to have a shop monkey. Otherwise known as an intern. Hey, welcome back. We're going to have fun with a new tool today. I've got a couple of projects that require cleats. I've made cleats in the past by hand, but I'm a weak-willed person. And so I have decided to give this nifty tool a shot. This is the StewMac cleat cutter, cookie cutter, press. I guess it's a cutter. And we're gonna use it on a couple of different woods. I've got some Sitka spruce, and I have some rosewood. And we're gonna take it out in a shop and see how easy it is to cut a bunch of cleats so that we can get some cracks fixed. So I don't have the invoice with me. Less than $40, maybe less than, it's probably less than 40, but more than 30. That's just my guess. So let's take it out into the oppressively cold confines of the garage and see what we can do. Okay, from a production standpoint, this would be a great time to have a shop monkey, otherwise known as an intern. Every time you're done with one of these, you have to freaking pick it out. Hey, if there's any smart woodworkers that would have any idea how to drop this off, I'd love to know it. Alright, now let's have some fun. Let's do some rosewood. Oh my gosh, that smells so good. Thank you. if you are lucky enough to have a shop monkey, then that would be great, because you can see I've got some spruce and I've got some rosewood. I only had one that kind of, I don't know if it was just some weird grain and it just split up kind of funny. The problem with the softer wood is if you start to make them too close together, they fall apart really quick. There's just the structural integrity isn't there. It's a little easier to do on the rosewood. You can pack them in there a little tighter just because the, you know, it's rosewood. So yeah, now we got a bunch of cleats, and then we're also, this is not going to go to waste, because another day when we have, you know, shop monkey day, then we'll have someone come down with this and the sander and make a bunch of rosewood dust for making repairs and stuff. So hey everybody, welcome back. We're now going to utilize a couple of things that we've done. We've made some cleats. We have made some cleat clamps, although the first thing that I want to do is, after I've made these, I got to thinking, because my brain like never shuts off. So what I wanted to do is just to sand the edge, the sharp edges off of these, so that in case I do get some good down pressure on there, I'm not going to leave like an indentation on the top of it. I also took, I just used it by hand, I just chamfered this a little bit, sanded it a little bit too, to make it nice and the smooth A. And then I wax it up so that way if we do get some glue kind of creeping up through here when we repair this crack, then we're not going to get our clamp stuck on top of our guitar, because that would, well, suck. You may notice this is my homemade crack demo. This is a piece of Western Red Cedar, and I have purposely cracked it right there. I thought about using the PV Clarksdale already cut in half guitar, but there's a problem with that. That guitar is made out of plywood, and plywood, she don't be splitting like this. So this is probably the scenario that you're going to use more often than not with these tools. I am also going to be doing this using just regular tight bond instead of hide glue in most instances. If I have a direct line to a crack through a sound hole perhaps, then more than likely I would hide glue that, just because if an instrument's put together with hide glue, I would prefer to put it together, back together with hide glue. But open time is going to be the big determining factor. If I can't get the thing in place before my glue cools off and starts to gel up, then what's the point? And then we'll just go ahead and we'll just use the tight bond. So we're going to simulate that this is a guitar top. You know what we're also going to do? We're also going to turn on this camera, and with any luck, using my highly technical, okay, with any luck, that's gonna show up just fine. I'm in that camera fine. You gotta look at me, sorry guys. So the first thing is that when these cleats come out of the cleat cutter, the spot where it is going across the grain, you tend to get some tear out. And that actually doesn't seem to be very species dependent, because you can see I've got tear out on rosewood, on Western Red Cedar, and on Sitka spruce. They all get that tear out on the edge, and so that's, and this is brand new out of the tube, so I think that's just kind of par for the course. And so I clean these up just a little bit,
because you want it to look nice, if you can see it from the top. And anything worth doing is worth doing right. And I'll be honest with you, even if I'm putting it in an area where you can't see it, I'm still going to do this. Because I don't sleep good doing stuff half-ass. Can I say half-ass? We'll find out. I'm sure someone will get offended and report me. Alright, so I've got two kind of smooth cleats. So the first thing we got to do is we got to get this piece of piano wire down through the crack. And you can see I've already kind of done a test hole right there. So we're not going to use that one. We're going to use this one. And this is just a piece of this very same music wire in this little pin vise. These all come from StewMac. You don't have to get them from there. I just got them as a kit. Gift certificates are wonderful. If you're wondering what to get me for my birthday, StewMac gift certificates work great because I tend to spend those on things that I would probably not really want to spend real money on. Real money? So now I'm going to put this piece of wire down, start it into this hole, and I'm going to try to kind of follow the crack here. And there I am. I am through. And because you want to make this hole as small as you can, but at the same time, you want to be able to pass this piece of wire down through there, which is not actually as easy as it sounds. So now that I have this piece of wire come through the hole, we're going to simulate. This is my simulated sound hole. So we're going to pretend that our sound hole is going to come up through here. Now our cleat is going to come on like this. And then we're going to retain our cleat with this nifty little thing. This is also comes from the StewMac, but after looking at it now, you could easily make this out of, you know, almost anything, especially if you have any kind of machine shop knowledge. This would be like the easy peasy thing to make because there is a hole going down vertically through this piece of brass, and then there's a hole going crosswise through it, and that allows you to put the wire through the hole and then to bring it back crossways and lock it in. And if you're lucky like I am, you're gonna stick that piece of wire right in your thumb. It's gonna hurt like hell. So the theory is that we put the glue onto our cleat and then we pull like that. Did that actually make it onto the footage? I can't tell. Sure looks like it did. Holy buckets. All right. We'll see. Is it in focus? Who knows? So now we're going to back this off. Again, we're going to pull this out through our simulated sound hole, which is right here. And then we're going to take this. This is going to come up through here. It's also going to come up through the hole on our tuner. Easier said than done, especially if you're an old fart like me. There we go. And so now here's the thing that I don't like about the round cleats. Because what we want to do, this piece of wood has the grain running this direction, and you want the grain to go 90 degrees to that, or if you talk to some people, they want it to go 45 degrees to that. You know, if you got a case hardcore for one way or the other, let me know. Put it in the sermon notes down below. So what I don't like is that because it's circular, you don't really have a way to gauge which way your grain is running. I have a couple of ideas on how I could do that, but I'm curious as to what you think you could do. So, you know what? I probably should have waited to clip that off until I had my glue on and I had it cinched up. So that's why you do a dry run, kids. We're going to glue this on the back here and hope that I don't run out of space on the cell phone camera before I can get this up there. This is going to take forever. All right, let's see. Here comes the money shot. So you know what? We're gonna do that again. All right, let's see if we can do this again with a much shorter piece of wire. I'm also gonna cheat. You know what? That's interesting. Let's take a look at this. Because my hole from where I was pretty sure I was coming down was going right through the crack, and it was not. So my crack crack is actually going back this direction, so we're going to go back this direction. Now let's take a look. Now I can't even see it. Oh, there it is. All right, let's try this again. That'd be great. Way up against there, yeah. Is that pulling that nice and tight? I'd certainly say so. I think we've got this one. I've got this secured better here. I have it just wrapped around here a little bit better. Let's glue the cleat. Okay, it feels tight. So now let's do the thing that you can't do with a guitar. We turn it over. Looks like I've got squeeze out all around. If I could, I would probably put my finger up and do that. And then we let it sit. So, see what that does. Next day, let's take a look. So you should probably wax this as well. Make sure you stick your finger with the wire. There's like no movement in that at all. So, you know, yeah, that's all right. Now, I should go ahead and mention, because I know someone's going to bring it up, there will of course be glue applied in here, but that's not what we're doing. We're just looking to see and try to figure out our process for putting the cleats on the back. So there they are, the StewMac cleat cutter dealio thingy, and these little thingies combined with homemade these little thingies. Oh, and this little dealy thing. And the cutter thing, which is in the shop, and I'm not going to go get it because it's cold. So, there we go. We kind of figured out how to do it. Now we're going to do it on a guitar, and that'll be in a different episode. So, cheers.
Hey, if you like this episode of Rattlecan Guitar Restorations, you might want to check this video out as well. Be sure to subscribe to us on YouTube, and if you'd like to help the channel grow, consider stepping over to our Patreon page and giving that a look. Y'all have a good weekend. Cheers.